Well, if you have your Bibles, turn to Isaiah 50. We're going to be looking at the third of the four servant songs that Isaiah gives. And so what we're having here is a Christology, but we're being given it in a progressive manner where each of the songs unveils a little more about the Lord Jesus. You're probably very familiar with Isaiah 53, but Isaiah 53 will carry an enormous weight and impact if you add what precedes 42, 49, and 50. And Isaiah not only gives us a progressive view of the Lord Jesus Christ, but he gives it to us in a real life situation. A moral and spiritual decline in the nation. The Jews are embracing idolatry again. And politically, a pretty gloomy prospect as Hezekiah, as an older king, has made some poor decisions and has a pretty selfish response to it. The Jews are looking at the next great event for the people of God is a Babylonian exile and judgment where God disciplines them for their idolatry. And so in light of all these you know, pretty dark colors, the question is, how do you live with a living God? And that, I think, is so applicable to us. You may feel that when you read Isaiah in these chapters that we're really in a situation much like that. So how do we live with the living God in a situation like that? I mean, there's all kinds of options for us. I mean, just today I got a text message from a church member who was really upset about government overreach. And so that's one option. You can go online and you can complain about the government. That's a pretty popular option. Not one I would suggest. Others, you know, get really offended at people who are not offended with the government. And so I had a pastor friend in Washington State say to me, he said, man, these are crazy days. He said, as a pastor, I'm just trying to get the people not to get on the crazy bus. But half of my members want to drive it. All right. So I hope that this sounds strange to you and you don't know what I'm talking about, but probably you do. But a serious question. Genuine believers really struggle in times like these to know, well, exactly how am I supposed to respond? And so Isaiah gives us a few very clear pictures of Christ with some simple commands. Look away from the things that you think will fill you up. Look away from the things that you think will fix the nation and look to the servant of God. Listen, close your ears to the thousand voices that are out there and tune your hearing to the one voice, the Master. Now we come to this chapter 50. At the end of chapter 49, we didn't read the refrain, but in verses 24, 25, and 26, God says some very encouraging things to the Jews who really, this is a purely gracious statement because they don't deserve this. They're after what we looked at this morning, basically they complain and they say, okay, those are fine words from the Messiah, that God will rescue us, that God will send the gospel out, not just to the Jews, but to the whole world. But look, let's be honest, it looks like God forgot us. So God responds to their complaint. And in verse 24 of Isaiah 49, he says, can the prey be taken from the mighty man, or the captives of a tyrant be rescued? Right, it's a good question. Can the captive be taken even from a strong man? Verse 25, surely thus says the Lord, even the captives of the mighty man will be taken away, and the prey of the tyrant will be rescued, for I will contend with the one who contends with you, and I will save your sons, and I will feed your oppressors with their own flesh, and they will become drunk with their own blood as with sweet wine, and all flesh will know that I, the Lord, am your Savior and your Redeemer, the Mighty One of Jacob. Wonderful, wonderful promises. But what we find in chapter 50 is a very sad contrast to this gospel-filled ending of chapter 49. What we're going to find is we're going to see the last picture of Jesus Christ, the coming servant. And the beauties of Christ are going to be laid before us by comparing them or contrasting them with the horrible failure of Israel as a servant. So Israel is a disobedient servant, and the Lord Jesus is the perfect servant So we're going to look at those two things. Now, I want to say before we look at it, it may seem like an obscure passage to you. You may have never really given it a close look, but it is such a helpful passage for us because it's going to describe both servants in a time of suffering, but for two very different reasons. And in this time of suffering, two very different responses. And listen, for the Christian, in this kind of world, we are often in this kind of situation. And regardless of why we're there, whether it's because God is lovingly disciplining his church, or it's because the world is antagonistic to your master, and so it's antagonistic to you, you're going to have to make up your mind. You're going to have to be one of these two. We want to follow the pattern of Christ, but if we're not careful, we find ourselves following the pattern of Israel. So let's look at these two, and we want to be followers of the Lord Jesus. So we're going to have to look close. And as we talked this morning, you know, a follower is a person that watches the actions of a person in front of them, and you mimic those actions. I use the illustration of following someone through like a city that you've never been in. So you're in a car and they're in a car, and when they change lanes, you change lanes. You don't know where they're going to end up. You don't know why they're changing lanes. You just watch them, mimic them. But when we're talking about following the Lord Jesus Christ, we do have to add a few details. We want to stick close to Christ, to constantly be setting the eyes upon Christ in Scripture. But we don't just mimic his actions. We're not just asking, okay, what is he doing now? But we're asking other things too. How does he do it? When does he do that? Why does he do that? So that the imitation of the Lord Jesus Christ in our own life goes beyond just kind of surface level, you know, religious activity. But there's a thorough transformation from the new nature, from the inward out. And we want to work outward into every area of our life, you know, the pattern of the Lord Jesus Christ. And it really is a great privilege, isn't it? I mean, I hope you don't think that Christianity looks like this. Free gift of justification, forgiveness, a full pardon, and then you got to kind of pay a little bit back with sanctification. When our youngest son was converted, the last of our children to be converted, he was about 16, and you know, you're always, as a minister, you're a little afraid when the kids profess faith. You think, well, is it just because they're the preacher's kid? So we tried to be careful with our children to guide them to Christ, but also to guide them away from any idea that, you know, this false profession of faith would be pleasing to us or would be worth anything. And the Lord was very kind to us. Our youngest, our son, Andrew, he is kind of the spoiled one, you know. And so I did often worry, like, will this be the one that really breaks our heart? He's 16 years old. He's not yet converted. Well, the Lord began to work, and he came to us, and it seemed, you know, he was talking about his soul, and we talked to him, you know, and so over a few days period, it seemed like there was genuine conversion. And then he would come and talk to me, you know, every night afterward, which was kind of unusual, about the Lord. So he'd come and he'd talk to me about the Bible, and that was a very encouraging, you know, change. He talked to me about Romans 5 one time. He said, Dad, Romans 5? I'm like, yeah, Andrew, what about it? He goes, about the best chapter in the Bible, Dad. Like, duh, what's your problem? You're a preacher. And I'm like, yeah, it's a great chapter. But I'm thinking the whole time, he's not our most bookish of our children. He wasn't the one that loved school, you know. And I'm thinking, Romans 5 is a bit of a deep end of the pool sometimes, you know. And he thinks it's just the most wonderful, simple chapter in the Bible. And I was really encouraged. But he kept coming to me and talking to me every night in the early days about sanctification issues, living for God. And so I had one little warning for him. I didn't want to throw a wet blanket on him. I said, look, Andrew, I'm really encouraged with this. But I do want to remind you, it's not sanctification that pays God for our sin. It's only what Christ did. Sanctification is just the gratitude that flows afterward. And he interrupted me. He looked at me like I was like, Dad. He said, I don't think of living for Jesus as payment back for the gift of justification. He said, I think of it as something that it's like I owe God double now. First, he forgave me, and then he let me live for him. And my life isn't worthless anymore. It's not just for nothing. It was quite a shocker for me to hear him talk that way. But I hope we all feel that way. I mean, we do when we're thinking rightly. The free gift of the cross, yes. But then there's the gift that the King has called me to imitate him. And when I see him face to face, it will not be a small gift then that the task of the believer was to walk in the footprints of the Lord Jesus. Well, let's look at the two servants. The failed servant Israel, verses 1, 2, and 3 of Isaiah 50. Thus says the Lord. And he's going to give them three questions that really points out to them their failure, all right? See if you can see these. Now, I'm reading from the New American Standard, so if you have the New King James, which I really like, or if you have the ESV, there might be a little differences, all right? But in the New American Standard, here's the three questions. Where, to whom, and why? So let me read this. Thus says the Lord, where is the certificate of divorce by which I have sent your mother away? Or to whom of my creditors did I sell you? Behold, you are sold for your iniquities, and for your transgressions your mother was sent away. Why was there no man when I came? When I called, why was there none to answer? Is my hand so short that it cannot ransom? Or have I no power to deliver? Behold, I dry up the sea with my rebuke. I make the rivers a wilderness. Their fish stink for lack of water and die of thirst. I clothe the heavens with blackness and make sackcloth their covering. Well, let's look at what he says there and kind of pull it apart and see if it has anything to say to us. In the previous chapters, as I mentioned, Isaiah has been, for the first 39 chapters, really, God has been using the prophet just to lay out this damning exposure of idolatry through the nation. Israel has filled her life with other gods, and she has failed as a servant of the true and living God, and thus what she's experiencing at this point is what we call the gracious judgment of God, the redemptive judgment of God. God has entered into, because of this covenant relationship, he has entered into a fatherly response to her sin. Other nations can live in idols, and for a while, you know, for a time, it seems that God doesn't even pay attention. But he will not let his people live this way. And verses 1 through 3 show that Israel has completely misunderstood the loving discipline of God. The activity of God in making her miserable is misunderstood. She thinks that God no longer cares. She thinks that God is no longer active. And so her response is a complete misunderstanding. And her response really is as much a sin as her original sin of idolatry and drifting. Now let's look at these three questions that exposes her response, her misunderstanding. The first question, verse 1, where? Where is the document that you have that demonstrates that I divorced your mother? Okay, why are you acting? Let's put it in a very simple picture. Why are you the wife, the people of God? I embraced you as a husband embraces a wife. Why are you acting like I divorced you? You're acting like spiritually divorced people. It's a pretty simple picture, isn't it? A marriage, you know, gets rocky and wrong decisions are made and it goes from bad to worse and there's a divorce and everyone is sad about it. The pain of that goes on. And it's not as if the Lord can't heal, but we see the consequences all around us. Israel is acting like God divorced her for her sin. And so she's gone for a while and now she feels free to date around and to find a new God. And so God asks her, how can you do this? You act like I divorced you. I never divorced you. You're not free to find another God. Second question, to whom did I sell you? You're living as if you were a servant that belonged to me and I was frustrated with you and sold you off. But you have not been sold off. And in the same way that you are not free to go find another husband, you're not free to go find another employer, another master, another Lord. Third question in verses 2 and 3, why? Why when I came to you was there no one that met me? Why, when I called to you, was there no one that answered me? And the reason behind all of that is really clear. You no longer believe. Israel no longer believes that it's worth seeking the Lord, responding to the Lord, obeying the Lord, even answering the Lord when he comes. And she has forgotten the power that he possesses to rescue. Did you notice in these verses that he gives that Exodus imagery? You know, when I come, you didn't even... Do you ever have people come and knock on your door and you know it's like a salesman? Or, boy, the worst time of the year for that is when it's politics. And so, you know, it's local elections and everybody comes to your door and you see them come up. Have you ever like hidden from them? You don't have to answer, but I'll answer for you. I have. Like, oh, great. It's another guy running for sheriff. And I see the car and I run and hide. And I hear the knock. And I don't meet him because I don't want to talk to him, you know. I already know who I'm voting for, and I don't want to have to tell the guy I'm not going to vote for him, so I just hide until he goes away. Have you ever done that with the Lord? But not because you don't love the Lord, you know, that you hate the Lord. It's just that, you know, when there are opportunities to meet the Lord, Israel just doesn't think it's really worth it. They've forgotten his strong arm. They don't believe. If we're going to really seek the Lord, we're going to have to believe that he is, remember Hebrews, and that he's a rewarder of those that seek him. So Israel doubting God and forgetting the spiritual amnesia, forgetting the mighty acts of God in the Exodus by which he had rescued them from Egypt, they are indifferent to his approach. Well, let's stop and apply this to ourselves before we look at the faithful servant. There are times when the believer, and I'm speaking to the believer, when the believer drifts from the Lord, we call it backsliding. The prophet says this, the backslider is filled with his own ways. That's a pretty clear picture. Backsliding is just when the heart that once in conversion turned its back on all that the world promised and even was willing to lay in the dust before Christ your goodness, not just the badness, but the goodness that you were hoping in. And Christ becomes your treasure. He becomes all in all. But as we go through life, if we're not careful, some of the old things creep back in on the edge, you know? And if that continues, it's like the Lord Jesus. It's like we just get filled up with the old ways and he's pushed to the periphery of life. And when that occurs, because of the love of the Father for his people, Hebrews tells us he promises that he will discipline us lovingly. And really, if we study this theme through Scripture, which we find this from beginning to end, I mean, we still find this in Revelation, don't we? The church of Laodicea, where's Christ? Outside. Knocking. That's a beautiful picture for a sinner. Christ is knocking at the door of your heart, will you let him? But that is not what that passage is talking about. Christ is outside his own church because his church has become filled with her own ways again. And she's self-sufficient and self-confident. And she's indifferent to her Lord. And so as a loving discipline, I'm not talking about losing your salvation, but they have lost that sweet sense of his nearness. And he's outside saying, if you would repent and throw open the doors, I would come back and sup with you. It would be like the restoration of a friendship where you're back across the table with the king. In Hosea, we read this. I mean, in Isaiah 63, the complaint of the prophet, where is he who once led Israel? There are times in the Christian life where, out of love for his people, God disciplines an individual drifting Christian or a drifting church. And the most common way in the Bible that he does this is to withdraw the awareness of his presence. That is, it feels as if God is letting us go through religion, but he doesn't attend church any longer. He doesn't work anymore. And everything we see happening could just be explained by, well, that's what we can do. Perhaps we've lived in this for so long that we've felt that this is the norm. Now, when we feel this distance between ourselves and our Lord, The enemy is ready to come in with this lie. He doesn't love you. He doesn't work in your life anymore. Now, as a believer, you look at your sin and you think, well, I wouldn't love me anymore either. And I would give up on me too. And if you give in to that lie, it will lead to more sin. So it's easy to do like Israel, to mistake. And we say, well, I feel like my husband divorced me. I feel like my Lord sold me. And you miss the entire point of the unhappiness of discipline. And that is, what is happening to a drifting church when it's miserable is that God is loving her and that God is working in her. But it's in a way that ought to make us stop in our tracks and say, enough, God, enough. Where are you? And we turn back. But when we drift and we misunderstand and we think God doesn't love us anymore, maybe as an individual, and you forget, you have that spiritual amnesia, you forget the power of God to save, not just once, but to continue to save, then you become indifferent. And like the failed servant here, some of the evidences of this are you're slow to meet him. You're reluctant to listen to him. And it's not because the preacher suddenly changed and you don't get anything. And the Bible we know didn't change. It's because of unbelief. So let's test ourselves this way. Are you drifting? Now, be careful. The spiritual drift we're talking about is often a secret. And it's certainly, first of all, an internal drift. And so you can be here tonight and the body can be in the right place and the heart be far away. Are you drifting? Pastor or parishioner, it doesn't matter. Mom, dad, child, spouse. Are you drifting internally from the Lord? What would the evidence be? Are you acting like God divorced you and you're free to find other lovers? Are you acting as if you no longer belong to the Lord as your master and you're free to follow other voices? Are you slow to come to the opportunities to meet with him privately in your own study of scripture, your prayer closet, publicly, corporately to the church? Are you slow to respond? Let me ask you this. When was the last time that because you believe God is still at work, you anticipated the meetings? What about individually? When was the last time you woke up in the morning and you said, God, I'm tired, all right? I didn't get much sleep last night. You know, the baby, whatever it is, I'm tired, but oh God, I want to meet you. I anticipate the time alone with you. So I want to get out of bed, shake off the sleepiness, you know, get my Bible and get alone. When was the last time you anticipated the meetings with the Lord with joy? When was the last time it was enticing to you when you thought of the opportunity to just get alone with God in your Bible? As a young Christian, I used to often get my Bible and I would go and just try to get alone. So I wasn't converted until I was in the middle of college. And so at age 20, I was converted and I would go camping. Now look, guys, I hate nature. I like the pictures of nature, but I hate nature. There's stuff out there that wants to kill you in Mississippi. So I go camping with my Bible. I take my Bible and a notebook and a pen, and that was all I took in my little tent, you know. So I go out and it's hot. And I'm out there sweating in this tent thinking, I'm not so sure this is a good idea. And so I'm gonna spend the whole like Friday and Saturday with the Lord. And I find a black widow on my pillow one morning, all right? Next day, I found a copperhead snake right beside my tent. So that was it, I was done with nature. I had to find another way. I used to, when I got older and I drank coffee, I would just go out in the mornings and I would take my Bible and a cup of coffee and I would just go walking through a field that was near my house and just anything to meet with the Lord. Have you ever read about Jonathan Edwards? During lunch, he would get on his horse and he would take his Bible and he would just ride his horse out into a meadow and then he would just walk and pray. And there's one wonderful occasion, extraordinary, where he said it was God was so sweet to open the scriptures and give him such a sight of Christ that he just, time passed without him realizing it, and he was there for hours. And then when he went back home, he said anytime someone came and talked to him about Christ, he couldn't quit crying. So he just had to kind of lock himself up for a week until he could get a grip on himself. When was the last time you anticipated the gathering of the saints on Sunday? I'm not just going because I'm a Christian. I want to be there. Look, just because I preach on Sundays doesn't mean my heart is right. You know, sometimes I think, I wish somebody else was preaching. My heart is cold. I've drifted. Am I doing this because it's what's expected of me? There are times where we drift and the Lord withdraws that wonderful presence and we doubt his love and we doubt his power. And one of the evidences is we are slow to meet him and quick to leave. You open your Bible in the morning because it's the right thing to do. But what does it take to dislodge you from that meeting with the Lord? Are you slow to come to the Bible and easily distracted, easily quick to leave? Is it because, like Israel, you have misunderstood God's response to your coldness and you doubt he loves you? And so what's the use of approaching a God that's angry? The key point we see with Israel is that in the time of real gloom and despair, because of her sin and God's response, instead of turning to God, she misunderstands this and she goes further from him. Now let's look at the faithful servant, the Lord Jesus Christ, suffering for a different reason, verses 4-9. The Lord God has given me, Christ says, the tongue of disciples, that I may know how to sustain the weary one with the word. He awakens me morning by morning. He awakens my ear to listen as a disciple. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not disobedient, nor did I turn back. I gave my back to those who strike me, and my cheeks to those who pluck out the beard. I did not cover my face from humiliation and spitting, for the Lord God helps me. Therefore, I am not disgraced. Therefore, I have set my face like flint. And I know that I will not be ashamed. He who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Let us stand up to each other. Who has a case against me? Let him draw near to me. Behold, the Lord God helps me. Who is he who condemns me? Behold, they will all wear out like a garment. The moth will eat them. Well, the faithful servant. Right off, we see this perfectly responsive one. But I want us to notice that the description that Isaiah gives of the perfect obedience of this servant, the Lord Jesus Christ, actually, he begins by describing the effects of his faithfulness, and then he goes to the roots of it. So he's got it back. First, it's fruits. Here's what it looks like. Here's what it produced. And then he describes the how. So what are the fruits? He says that God gave him the tongue of a disciple so that he would have words to share that would give comfort. When we think about the Lord Jesus Christ speaking, we see the testimony in the New Testament that this is exactly true. His enemies come back and say, no man ever spoke like this man. His own followers say, did our hearts not burn when he met with us on the way? When we see the Lord Jesus Christ in the Gospels teaching, here is the voice of God, Genesis chapter 1 kind of voice. Or think of Psalm 29 when in that wonderful psalm where he describes this infinite power in the voice of the deity. And here's that voice coming from the lips of a man. But how does he know what to say at the right time so that it brings real strengthening to his people? Well, Isaiah 50 explains how. Morning by morning, he awakens me. He awakens my ear. Morning by morning, the Lord Jesus Christ is awakened by the Father. And like you and I, he has to go and open the scriptures and he has to listen and learn. I know that without a sinful nature, there's no block between him and the Father. You know, oftentimes, you know, I feel like I'm looking at God through a window pane that's splattered with mud, my own selfishness and fears and pride, and my ears are so clogged. So yes, there's no sin nature there like that, but this is a real man meeting with God through the scriptures by the aid of the Holy Spirit. If we want proof for that, let's just look at the New Testament. I want us to look at a couple of passages in the Gospel of John where Jesus describes what Isaiah just hints at, how he meets with the Father. Look at John chapter 7, verse 16. When Jesus describes his teaching, in verse 16 he says this, Jesus answered and said to them, "My teaching is not mine, but his who sent me." Well, that's easy for us to accept. He's after all, he's the Son of God. We'll turn to chapter 8. Look at verse 28. Jesus said, "When you lift up the Son of Man, then you will know that I am he, and I do nothing on my own initiative. But I speak these things as the Father taught me." There's our key phrase there, "as the Father taught me." Look at John 8, 38. "I speak the things which I have seen with my Father. Therefore, you also do the things which you heard from your father." Look at verse 40. "But as it is, you're seeking to kill me, a man who told you the truth which I heard from God." Look at John chapter 12, verse 49. "For I did not speak on my own initiative, but the Father himself who sent me has given me a commandment as to what to say and what to speak." If you gather these little glimpses of the inner life of our Lord, what do we see? Isaiah says God will wake him up morning by morning, and God will give the Messiah exactly what to say. But if you read John, you find the details filled out. "Things that I was taught by the Father, things that I saw when I was alone with the Father, things which I heard with the Father." Well, when? Well, what about Mark chapter 1? Listen to what we read in verse 32. "When evening came, after the sun had set, they began bringing to him all who were ill and those who were demon-possessed, and the whole city had gathered at the door. And he healed many who were ill with various diseases and cast out many demons. And he was not permitting the demons to speak because they knew who he was. In the early morning," so late night, "in the early morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, left the house, and went away to a secluded place and was praying there." Surely that's part of where he learned. What about Psalm 40, verse 6? "Sacrifice and meal offering you have not desired, my ears you have opened. Burnt offering and sin offering you have not required. Then I said, behold, I come, in the scroll of the book it's written of me. I delight to do your will. Oh my God, your law is written within my heart." What a picture of a pattern of the servant of God, fully God, the eternal Son, possessing equally and eternally all the perfections of deity with the Father and Spirit. And yet in the work, or what the theologians call the economy, the acting out, the accomplishing of the plan of redemption, he takes on true humanity. And as man, he must do what our kinsmen must do. And he must wake up every morning and listen to the Father like you have to wake up and listen to the Father. I was reading a biography recently, Andrew Benar's diary. Benar was the fellow that wrote the biography of his best friend, Robert Murray McShane, that I mentioned this weekend. Benar is one of my favorites because he was never the superstar. All right, McShane was the superstar. William Burns, another Scottish guy, he was the superstar of the revivals in the 1830s and 40s. Benar lived like 80 years and was never the superstar preacher. But the faithful, consistent, godly, prayerful man. And he was a pastor who pastored during three waves of extraordinary reviving times, seasons of grace. But when he was 23 years old in college, actually right out of college in his first pastorate, he writes in one of his journal entries that communion with God is the secret of the minister's life. But the very next day he writes this: I am learning that communion with God is the end and not a means to a greater end. So when we talk about the servant and following the servant, don't get this idea in your mind. Okay, as a pastor, I need to really walk close with the Lord so that I can be a more effective pastor. As a parent, I really need to walk close to the Lord so I can be a more effective parent. As a teacher in the church, as a deacon, as a witness at work, I need to draw near to the Lord and hold closer fellowship with the Lord so I can be more effective. But that's not why. The treasure of the Christian life is that you can walk with the King. And that's not something that God gives us so that we can be better us's, you know, more effective people in the kingdom. That's the highest gift. If we follow the servant, that's where we start. Now, the result of him being wakened morning by morning is that he has these words that bring comfort to the people. But there's another result, and this is really shocking. He's attacked and hated. Look at verse 5. Turn back to Isaiah 50, verse 5. Let me give you verse 5, then I'll get to verse 6. All right, let me give you one. I skipped one by accident, all right? One of the results of this was that he was obedient. So he doesn't just wake up and hear the Father speak to him through the word, but he's obedient. Now in the Hebrew, he gives two pictures of disobedience that he avoided, all right? He says, I did not disobey, and I did not openly rebel, and I did not turn aside. Now, however your Bible translates that, the two Hebrew words mean this. The first is this: I did not openly rebel against the Father. No matter what he said day by day in his word, I never, as the Son of God, raised my fist to heaven and said, no, not that one. I'm not doing that today. But the second word, a little more subtle: I never stepped aside. I never turned aside. It's a Hebrew word for when something is coming straight at you, you just move a little to the side and you let it pass you by. The Lord Jesus Christ never once, not as a child, not as an adult, not on the cross, all right? Not in the good times or the bad times, did he ever quietly see the command of God in the scripture and then just step aside and pretend like he didn't see it and let it pass him by. Now that was one result of listening, but the other result I jumped ahead and said was that he was attacked. Look at verse 6. I gave my back to those who strike me, and my cheeks to those who pluck out the beard, and I did not cover my face from humiliation and spitting. Now what we find is this: that when the Lord Jesus Christ perfectly obeys the Father, there is one day that arrives, and that's the day that he will become the sin bearer. Have you ever thought of that? The one thing he hates with infinite hatred and has never come close to: rebellion against his Father, the shame and the stain of sin. Not as eternal God, and certainly, and not as man, has he ever embraced sin. And Christ becomes sin for us. Now, he doesn't become sinful. He becomes the sin bearer, our representative. And the Father places upon him, it's a divine act, he transfers or imputes our guilt and shame to his Son. Every sin of every believer of every day, the least of every believer's sins, and the most heinous, the kind of things that if it were to be played behind me on a big screen, if your sins were to be put on a screen and people watched them, what would you do? You'd run out the back of the door and you'd never return. You couldn't bear to see those people again. And Christ becomes the embodiment of all of that. He becomes the curse itself. And the infinite wrath of the Father crashes against him. And the day that he realizes, as he's walking with the Father and he's meeting with him in the morning, today is the day he does not turn, he does not rebel, he doesn't sidestep and say, let's pretend that you didn't say that. And so he gives the instance here, the prophet gives in verse 6. Obviously, he's pointing to the cross. Even on that day, he's obedient. Now, what we're watching is the culmination of 33 years of perfect self-dedication. Jesus tells us in John chapter 4, to do the will of my Father, that's my food. John chapter 6, verse 38, it's the purpose for which I exist. John chapter 8, verse 29, it's the reason I have always enjoyed the nearness of my Father. John chapter 5, and again in John chapter 10, it is the validation that I am who I say I am. He says things like, if I'm the only one saying this, well, don't believe me, but look at my works. Can you imagine writing that across the front of the church entrance? If we don't do the will of our Father in heaven, don't listen to us. And at the end of 33 years, the ultimate expression, the final expression, but it's just one of the expressions of the man that is awakened morning by morning as a child, as a teenager, as an adult, and he hears from his Father and his heart is perfectly responsive. The ultimate expression is when it's the cross, he still doesn't sidestep it. How does he endure? Verses 7 through 9, the little word for. Because the Lord God helps me. I know I'm not going to be disgraced, he says. I'm not going to be ashamed. I set my face like flint to do the Father's will. Do you remember John 14 when he has the disciples alone on that night? He's going to be arrested. And before they leave the upper room, he says, it's time for us to get up and go now, basically. And he says, the evil one has nothing in me. But that the world may know that I love my Father, I go to do his will. He had just told them, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. And then the ultimate example of that is, I love the Father, so I'm going to go to the cross. I've set my face like flint. God is near me to vindicate me. And the picture there is like a court scene. Well, who will come against me with any accusation? I mean, the whole world thinks that God is angry at this man. He's on the cross. Obviously, he must have done something terrible. He must have been a fraud or a liar. Isn't the one that is lifted up on a tree cursed of God? And so the people are there mocking him. Well, if the Father really loves you, why don't you cry out to him and he'll get you down? But Christ endures knowing that if anyone brings a charge against him, whether it's Herod, the king, or the Sanhedrin, or cowardly Pilate, the governor official, when they come against him, they will crash against his purity and they'll wear out like an old garment. And it's been that way for the last 2,000 years. All the enemies of this servant will destroy themselves in their attempt to rebel against him. What comes next, of course, is Isaiah 53. The shocking sight of the God-man marred beyond description on the cross, bearing our sin, and then triumphant. But how do we apply this chapter to us? Very simple application for Christians in Rhode Island. The New England area, obviously, is awash with, everything from atheism to witchcraft, to liberalism. When I was in Yale filming, I told your pastor, when I was in Yale filming the first Behold Your God study, we were there, we were at Yale, we were where was Edwards? Edwards, New Haven, Connecticut. So I was in New Haven that time, I wasn't Yale. So we were in New Haven, and I heard a religious professor at a college, a professor of Christianity, so-called, sitting down with a Muslim international student, explaining to him that all roads basically lead to God. Your Quran, my Bible, it's really the same thing. As I walked down the street, I saw all these Wiccan outposts, you know, these, you know, witchcraft. And then the church that Edwards pastored has a big rainbow flag above it. Very clear that they want, when the company that made The Beholder, when the publishing company offered to give that church a fee for using the church that day to film in, they said, okay, so what do you believe? And we told them, they said, we don't want your money. New England is a dark place. Certainly not hopeless, but it's a dark place. Mississippi is a dark place, just a different type of darkness. But surely we would know that New England needs the right words to be brought to her in the right way by God's people, now, if ever. But it will not be by a group of people who know the 1689 confession. And it will not be by a group of people who can explain all 5 points of Calvinism, no matter what passage you bring up. And it will not be the group of people that are really religious and always at church. Those are all great things, but that's not enough. It will be the people that follow the Lord in this. Morning by morning, he awakened me. Morning by morning, he opened my ears. And I was not rebellious. And I didn't quietly sidestep obedience. And little by little, wherever God uses you, wherever you're surrounded by the needy, whether it's at work or at home or at church, he gave me the right things to say at the right time. We want to be the kind of people that don't just admire the Lord Jesus and repeat the same words that he repeated. We want to make sure that our feet are really stepping in the path that he stepped in. In Isaiah 42, 49, and now 50, very clear pattern for all of us. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for giving us not only the glorious work of our Savior, but such a clear path to walk. We're thankful that he doesn't just call us to take that path, but it is the path that he so frequently meets us on. And we're allowed to have the fellowship of the King in the midst of everyday mundane events. And so we plead with you, God, that you grant us both the desire and the ability to put our feet in these footprints and to take the Lord Jesus afresh as the only option for living in Rhode Island or Connecticut or Massachusetts or Mississippi in this present hour, how to live with the living God. And we ask that you would demonstrate through our very common lives the uncommon beauty of the Lord Jesus Christ. Do it, Father, we pray, for his name's sake. Amen. Amen.